medicine into the market, and pharmacovigilance department will contribute in a big way in the future when the new molecules will be introduced. Ethical promotion plays an important aspect today, and I think those who promote the ethical brand, they are the brand leaders, they are the contributors, and they can make India a superpower. Today we are talking about the patient counseling. It's not only that manufacturing through the CGMP, the quality is produced. Whether we are delivering the quality through the service, through the community pharmacies, taking the example of the patient counseling, drug-drug interactions, inventory management, I think our pharmacies today should be trained by the pharmacy people or maybe through the community pharmacy so that the best service to the patient counseling, building the confidence in the patient while taking the drug, avoiding the drug-drug interaction, talking to the doctor will be the major role in the future if you really wanted to become the superpower. We can become the superpower as far as the turnovers of medicine is considered. But as far as the special service is considered, where the patient will be benefited, I think the role of the community pharmacist, clinical pharmacist, therapeutic drug monitoring, taking actually the role along with the doctor, shoulder to shoulder, taking the samples of the blood and the urine and identifying the toxicity level in the blood and the urine and suggesting the doctor to increase the dose and reduce the dose will be the job of the pharmacist if really the superpower we wanted to bring into the picture. Environment protection is also important. Whatever the excreta which we are producing, I think that should be safe. So a lot of things which we have to do today to make this world more beautiful and more safe. Everybody is talking today about the economy. Even Barack Obama has given the statement that the quality of the medicine, absolutely no problem. But can you bring down the economy as far as the top brands are considered? Can you make the drug available, which is really affordable to the people, even in the US, which he is talking? Even 45% of the people in the US cannot afford the drug because of the quality as well as the price. But India, we have the destination, we have the capacity to make it more economic. Through the productivity, through maintaining the quality throughout, we should not talk only about the productivity, but maintaining the quality is also important. One of the audits when we were conducting, we just tested one of the worker in that company that can you increase the speed? Why you are actually not increasing the speed of the machine? Productivity will be more. And we got a beautiful answer from that worker. He said, I think the speed is not validated as far as the quality is considered, so I cannot increase the speed, although the productivity will increase. And I think that should be the attitude from every person, whether you are working in a pharmaceutical industry at various stages, that whenever you are going for the productivity, maintain the quality. Zero defect output, we always say, and that's why the automation, validation, calibration, all these things will come into the picture. Even computer validation, I think we have to go ahead in that area if you really wanted to become the superpower. Outsourcing, because of the economy, the way the things are happening in IT, I think the same way, the PT, that is pharmaceutical technology, is going to contribute. And the plants, which we have 172 approved plants of US FDA or MHRA, as well as the MCC South Africa and TGA, I think a lot of work which you will get. And if we maintain that quality and productivity, India can actually contribute in a big way to the pharmaceuticals. Training people to upgrade the knowledge, develop the skill, and building the positive attitude is most important. Creating that passion that I'm working in a pharmaceutical industry, and that is contributing to save the lives of the people. So we can say one life equivalent to one earth. Can you save one life? Can you protect one life? Can you extend one life? Can you nurture one life? That will be the biggest contribution as a pharmacist we can do when we are working in the pharmaceutical profession. And we can. We can because we have that attitude to contribute to serve the humanity. 30,000 diseases identified on this planet, and we have the remedy only for 20,000 diseases. 10,000 diseases, we have the challenge in front of us. Cancer, no answer. A lot of research is going on. Diabetes, once per person suffered, diabetes become the friend, and we have to take care of that friend. Heart problem, cholesterol deposition. I think n number of challenges. Even the swine flu, I think the way it is affected 2 years back in Pune, I think industry has given the solution, whether it is Serum Institute of India, whether it is Zydus Cadila or Panacea Biotech, and that's why the immunity which is produced in our body taking care of that virus. Challenges are n number, but the purpose of life is to accept the challenges. Strength, low cost of production, abundance installed capacity today, efficient technology for large number of generics, that is the advantage, and that's why we can actually supply the drugs with quality, and that can be the generics in that case where the drug is off-patented. Large pool of skilled manpower which we have. We have developed them. with our training programs, with our exposure, and I think we can contribute in that area, and that's why the economy can be achieved. Opportunities in front of us, aging of the world population, geriatric problems, and whenever above the 60, when our kidneys are not working, our actually liver is not working, where the toxicity to both these organs are playing the important role. I think we have to concentrate on this, and that's why we have to contribute even in geriatrics, where the challenges and opportunities are more, but the consumption of the drug is increasing day by day after 60, and that's why I think we have to serve the quality medicines in this area. Increasing use of generic drugs, even whatever the program of Amir Khan or today Manmohan Singh, they are talking about generics. And can India contribute in the generics? Yes, we can, because we have the capacity to produce the quality medicine, and we have the systems to build the quality, and we have actually everything which is going for the economy as far as our country is considered. So that is the cost advantage. Large number of drugs getting off-patented is the advantage for us, opportunity for us. So let's exploit that by actually producing the quality medicines and opening up new market, whether it's the Southeast Asia or maybe the African countries. I think the huge market actually India is having. Among the fastest growing pharma market, 15%, more than 26,000 pharmaceutical companies we say, but more than 300 companies are really contributing in big way because they have the special system which is building the quality of the medicines. 12.7% share of generic market says that we can capture the world, and 3-4% share of world pharmaceutical market at present, but that may go to 10-12% around 2020. Global market share increased by 5.5% from 2010 to 2.8% in 2007 shows that India is really contributing. Expertise from bacteria to beaker to water to body now available. Clinical research, we are contributing in a big way. We have the biggest opportunity because of the population. In fact, that is the advantage of India when we are talking about the population. Good news, US FDA data, approvals 442 total, and out of that India got 170, maybe 172, that is the right figure. Sun Pharma, Dilip Sanghvi's group leading with 23, Arbindo 16, while Dr. Reddy's 14, and Sardana's Glenmark with 12 approvals, while Deshbandhu Gupta's Lupin is actually going with 11 approvals, and I think that is the biggest achievement outside the US. The largest actually plants or the products which are approved by US FDA, that is only India, and that's why we have a very good chance to contribute. Friends, the pharmaceutical sales as per the global part is considered in 2015, it is estimated, and if you can see the figures, I think 15.3%, that will be the growth rate of India, 15.3%, adjacent countries again contributing 12.2%, and that is the CIS countries contributing, is going to contribute. So it's a big chunk of actually consumption of drugs which will be required, but the quality medicines will be required. Come to the North America, I think 12.2%. And looking to all these scenarios, I think India can be the destination to contribute to the world as far as the quality medicines are considered. So many times we are debating this, today also we are going to debate on this brand India when we are going to take it abroad. And looking to the history of Indian pharmaceutical industry and the profession, we have contributed a lot. So one video which I wanted to show you, the way the contribution has happened from 1947. Sound.
जाना है हाँ यही सपना है तेरा तूने पहचाना है
Sound.
Absolutely magnificent. Tony finishes off in style. A magnificent strike into the crowd. India left the World Cup. A
28 years, the bodies start in the dressing room, and it's an Indian captain who's been absolutely magnificent in the night of the final.
We won the World Cup in actually the cricket. And one of you should be the Mahendra Singh Dhoni 2020 Pharmaceutical World Cup. And if we produce that quality medicine, I think that destination and the dream will be the reality. Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, he said, look at the sky, we are not alone. The whole universe conspiring and only giving the best to those who dream and those who bring that dream into the reality. All the best for the pharmaceutical industry for 2020 Pharma Superpower. Thank you very much. Friends, I have given the opportunity to introduce a great leader who is bringing the leaders together on this platform. And that leader in front of us is Satya Brahma. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of ever-growing pharmacy profession and pharma leaders, we wish you a very, very happy and healthy good afternoon. Nothing is impossible in this world if you give the foundation which is solid and opening which is confident. Let me invite the confident and dynamic Satya Brahma, Chairman and Editor-in-Chief Pharmaleaders, for his opening address in Asia's biggest leadership event, that is 5th Annual Pharmaceutical Leadership Summit and Pharma Leaders Business Leadership Award 2012. Brand India, Beyond Generics, Leading with Resilience. Satya Brahma, please.
Thank you, Dr. Puranda, for your kind words. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of Pharma Leaders, Ministry of Commerce, Pharmaxil, India Brand Equity Foundations, and various other organizations who have been involved in these programs, I welcome you all for this momentous occasion, which will probably rewrite the history of Indian pharmaceutical industry when it comes to reforms. I am privileged to have with us the shining stars of the Indian pharma industry here, and I am really indebted for them for having accepted my invitations since 1999 till down now. So today we are going to witness some of the thought leaders of the society who are going to speak about the subject that has the burning, but these are the subjects which are also very controversial. So over the next 3 to 4 hours, the entire atmosphere and the entire hall is going to be seeing a sort of a catastrophe when it comes to the thinking and attitude. I was closely watching Dr. Borande when he was speaking about Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. But my worry is, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam was the President of India. I also know, even there is a platform given to Dr. Abdul Kalam or Pranab Mukherjee, he will beat 100 times. But the biggest problem that we have is the political class of the society who are trying to exploit us. Dr. APJ Kalam could not be elected as a president because all the people didn't want him to be elected, and he stayed away from it. And the biggest tragedy is that the name which was proposed by Samajwadi Party, Mulayam, then Mamata, when they declared the name of APJ Abdul Kalam, was not available. I spoke to APJ after that when the announcement made, it will not ever of anything. They spoke of one name, Dr. Manmohan Singh, who is the architect of Indian economy and who opened up the plethora of opportunities in the global area and the globalizations. Today, what you're seeing is only because of him. Whatever may be the political controversy, it doesn't come to Dr. Manmohan Singh, because I have interviewed him and I've also found out he is surrounded with the people where some of the decisions are going to be very tough. But I can tell you, in the next 30 to 40 days, situation is going to change. Maybe sources close to Pharma leaders and Indian affairs, there might be a leadership change which is going to affect, because paving the way for the new generations. Indian pharmaceutical industry is one of the biggest healthcare industry, and it is fourth in largest industry. And the theme of this summit, when I was conceptualizing, was going in a different direction. Now, when they came to know that I am organizing this fifth edition of the Pharma Summit, Anand Sharma called me, the Commerce Ministry, and he told, since we are promoting brands, generic brands, so let us partner with us. I have no objections in partnering. I have partnered with them, and it's a great effort. There is a lot of speculations going on that free medicines to be available and all. There is a controversy coming out that MNC companies and domestic companies are classing. I can tell you one thing very crystal clear here. This message also can go to the Ministry of Commerce. Some of the esteemed members of press were present. Thought leaders were present here. There is no divide of thought. Because what about the patient safety? You were talking about 367 to 368 drugs who should come under the purview of the generics, and you're going to make it available for the doctors to prescribe it. Is it ethical? My question to you is very simple. Is it ethical on part of the doctors, who are considered to be the gods in the remote villages, even in towns also, to prescribe a medicine which is not ever up? Do we know which manufacturing facility is coming from? Do we know the standards are the maintaining? Is it maintaining that kind of quality standards and regulatory practice? Knowing the government's nature, knowing the policy making formation, I have every doubt to feel that this is going to be a major task for the government. I am an optimist. If it goes, it goes well, and it's going to create a plethora of opportunities. But telling doctors that you prescribe this brand, this generic, don't prescribe the brand, is a wrong term. We have spent millions of rupees in branding. We have created those brands. These brands have gone into so much of phase of clinical trials, regulatory affairs, and everything. We cannot obviously tell doctors to erase of those brands and prescribe a particular generic which doesn't have anything actually. To my concept, it's not correct, and this should actually be reframed. But I was told by the Prime Minister's office that they're taking every care to ensure that the quality of medicines are going to be affected. And I think 5 days before, when I was in Delhi, there was a meeting with the Ministry of Commerce. Finally, they have added the multinational companies to come into the fold. They were not adding them because they wanted domestic companies to be part of it. Let us not forget, from 1947 till date, for the last 3-4 decades, it was the MNCs who dominated the Indian pharma industry. We are talking about the FDI, we are talking about the FDI and various other things. A lot of problems are happening because not allowing the FDI players to come in. I am in favor of opening up the FDI, because large number of companies can come in. There will be technology transfer, there will be R&D innovations, there will be so much of partnership will go. But these political sections of the society are creating a stumbling blocks to make this task a much, much more complex one. But I am sure with you leaders like this, you will share with me opinion, although you cannot speak in public platform because of some limitations or other, that the government which is planning now, the free generic medicines to is not going to happen. At least to my knowledge, it's not going to happen, because you've seen so much of policies, you've seen so much of actions. When the money comes from one section to another, it gets squandered away. The money goes everywhere. So the government is a toothless tiger. They don't know how to operate directly, because they are surrounded by the MNCs. Sorry, I'm so sorry. They are surrounded by the policy makers and the ministers who have squandered all the money. But I have due respect for those ministers, those policy makers, who are also very honest, and they're trying to give a new direction. I hope this is going to a big task on the part of the government to implement the strategy. We welcome the decisions of the Ministry of Commerce when they talk about the free medicines, and many of the media also have reported, and also negative media reports are coming out. So this is the situation which are facing now, and I can tell you this platform also will open up a lot of healthcare reforms that is going to dominate in the world map. President Barack Obama, when he visited India, he visited a lot of the places, he went everywhere and praised India like anything. When he went back to the states for other places, He criticized various policies because of the obvious vote banks. Is Barack Obama, I'm asking a very fundamental question. Now this Nobel Prize, Peace Prize, which Barack Obama got it, in anticipation that he's going to do something, proved to be fatally wrong. So the Nobel Prize is a very prestigious institution. They must rethink and take back the award which they have given it to Barack Obama. He's obviously losing grounds, I can tell you with full confidence. He doesn't connect with the masses. He is a great orator. I respect his oratory, but let us put it into practice. Let us translate into practice. He talks about a healthcare reform. There are so many lacunas. He is keeping the vote banks into practice. He is pleasing those sections of society which are there. But there is a widespread protest in various states in the United States, and Barack Obama is the chief culprit, who is spreading all sight of inflammatory sentences, which is in fact will not be a good sign for the world market. So through this message, I would like to tell Barack Obama to rethink about his strategy. Let him put his feet firmly on the ground. Let us think the wider this thing. Let us not give abuses to India and everything because of the outsourcing issue, not others. He is a world leader, but he cannot dominate us. India is no less than a superpower actually. India, we have got a lot of pharmaceutical company, FDA approved, and we are the world's largest. We simply cannot take it like this. So with this remarks, I would like to conclude, and I hope you'll have a very good session. And in the evening, His Excellency, Sri K. Sankaranarayan will be present with full force. And this is going to be at from 7:30 to 9 o'clock is the award presentation. But before that, there are some interesting lectures. And one of the lectures is going to be Dr. Mukesh Batra, who flew from Boston to here. The person who operated on Prime Minister Manmohan Singh, first time we were back in London, J.R.D. Tata, and many other celebrities. He told, what I'm going to do, I don't speak. I told, you have to come and give the presentation. He is talking about something, he's telling that the heart surgery in India is going to cost 50,000 rupees. I can't believe it. Because it will cost 5 to 6 lakhs rupees. I think he's carrying in his pocket artificial surgery, artificial heart, and showing on screen one girl who is exercising, and they're dancing. How is it possible? The entire media is looking at what he's going to speak. And the various other speakers like iconic Dr. Mukesh Batra, there is Mr. Kewal Handa, and various other people are present here. And I take this opportunity to thank you, all of you. You have been very wonderful. You have really supported me for this initiative. All my statements, all my opinions that I express are purely my own, and I don't subscribe to all the views which everybody has stated. And with these notes, I would like to continue. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Satya Brahma. The next speaker is Dr. Kewal Handa. Brand is the image, brand is the status, brand is the recognition, brand is the quality, and quality means excellence. Pharma Leaders invite excellent and brilliant contributor Kewal Handa, Managing Director of Pfizer Limited and White Limited, to give the keynote address on branded formulations versus branded generics. 2012 pharmaceutical diversification trends. Mr. Kewal Handa, please.
Okay, so a very good afternoon to all of you. It's a very interesting topic on generics, branded generics. To my mind, we need to first have the nomenclature clarified. Just let's wait for a minute. Thank you. don't you load it from my pen drive? Okay, great. So, Bob, thanks a lot. Okay, let's get into this little bit of exciting topic on branded generics and generics. I love this topic for a simple reason is it brings up some clarity how India is going to be doing business in future. This is an R&D spend of various sectors. The pharmaceuticals and biotechnology spends almost about 16%, both in terms of the euros or dollars, and also in terms of percentage of sales. This sector spends the maximum. I would have thought about IT and computer services actually spending the most, because they earn the most. They earn maximum than what the pharmaceutical industry is earning. But look at software and computerization. They spend only 10% and just about 26 million euros as compared to pharmaceutical, almost three times more. And maybe three times more riskier than IT and software. And half the earnings of IT and software. So let's understand the context where we are in R&D spend today. R&D spend is risky. Still, the pharmaceutical segment is spending a lot on R&D. They are still betting on future. And whether it's good or bad, we need to really understand. If pharmaceutical companies don't spend, who's going to spend on R&D? Is government going to spend? Are educational institutions going to spend? Or the philanthropy institutes going to spend? If nobody is going to spend on R&D, what's going to be the future for our next generations? Where are the new medicines going to come? So these are the big questions that we need to answer before we really get into and criticize every spend that takes place in R&D. This is access to medicines. There's a lot of criticism also that multinational companies do not provide access to medicines. These are all proprietary based companies which are original discoveries they do. Now if you look at them and if you look at access should not be looked at just from a narrow funnel of pricing. Let me tell you that's again a mistaken notion of access, to look access as only lower prices, as some of the Indian companies tend to make it out that access is lower prices. You look access from management point of view, public policy, from the research point of view, pricing is just one of the elements, and from the patents discovery, and from the complexities that happens, and finally, the actual philanthropy, the work, the CSR that is done by these companies. And top on the list really is Glaxo. It's really on the top of the list if you look at all these parameters on terms of ranking. Merck comes second, and then comes Novartis. And I know everybody talks about the Glivec case, but don't forget, Novartis is number three in providing access to the pharmaceutical products globally. So I think this is something which we should all appreciate and understand before we just say the prices of pharmaceutical products are pretty high. Now there is a little bit of ranking done for generic companies also. As compared to the original discovery companies, the generic companies came much, much below the ranking. And therefore, they were separately classified then and within themselves as to how do we say lung fever. The dark purple color you see, I don't know what's the color on the screen now. Is it purple or red? It's still purple, so fortunately it's working. The dark purple color you see is something that is on the high, and Ranbaxy actually stood very high. And that's what we were really all proud of. An Indian company, Ranbaxy, is really providing access of different parametrics, though not at the same level as an MNC company or original discovery. But in spite of being an Indian company, it was providing a great access. Then comes Cipla's and then Reddy's, and I don't think so there are any other companies that we can talk of. So please understand that if you look at all Indian companies and they say which are the ones who are really providing access to medicine, there are a handful of two or three companies only, and rest just make noises. They don't do anything. So I think we need to understand that context very, very clearly. This is a slide, now come to Indian. So move away from global to India and then look at how Indian pharmaceutical companies are doing. We're having a very healthy growth of 16%. It's only in the last 4 years the trajectory of growth has gone double digit. Let me tell you that also. Prior to that, we were growing just around 9-10%. It's only in the last 3 years you have seen such a high growth of 16%. Now comes the crux of the problem. What is generics? What is branded generics? And what are patented products? Now, it's very, very, you know, nomenclature needs to be very, very clearly understood. And then comparisons can be made very carefully, and comparison can be appreciated also once you understand the nomenclature. A branded generics contains one or more ingredient marketed under a brand name given to them by the manufacturer. So, if you have one or more ingredients and there is a brand associated with it, it's simply a branded generic. It could be a patented product or it could be a non-patented product. Now, there is this question mark. Because a non-patented product in India are also known as branded generics. Whereas in US, the classification is only two. It's branded generics or generics, or rather patented products and non-patented products. There is no third classification. Whereas we Indians have invented a third classification called as generic generics. And what you hear about the euphoria of the government and all the other statements made by the actors and so on and so forth are all related to generic generics, not even to branded generics. Let me make that point also very clear. What they are talking about is generic generics and not even branded generics. Now, in a generic drug is a medicine marketed under its chemical or salt name. It will not have a brand. It will be marketed in a chemical or a salt name and sold without a brand. That's a generic purely. And that's how the US functions. There are brands for the original products and there are no brands and sold as generic. Is that very clear? However, we have in between something called branded generics. Now, look at Indian markets. 94% of the Indian market is branded generics. We understood the definition of branded generics. And only 5% of the market is generics. And patented drugs is less than 0.5%. Forget about it. Just they don't exist at this point of time. There are only 14 drugs which have got patented, out of which 8 or 9 are under litigation. So there is nothing really to talk about. One or two that are surviving, I understand they are also under litigation or likely to be under litigation. So at the end of the 14, my belief is there would be none patent products in the market without litigation. So that's going to be the challenge. So 94% is branded generic. Now, what our good friends are doing? Our good friends are saying that 5% should become 90% and 90% should become 5% in India. That's what they're saying. Now, if that happens, think about it. The market today is, let's say, 50,000 crore for simplifying purposes. 90% of 55,000 crore is around roughly about 45,000. If you make that 45,000 crores into generic market, you will lose roughly around 30 to 40% of that. Because that's what the government figure says, that the prices of generics are lower than branded generics by 30 to 40%. So I'm just using what the government logics are. 30% of 50,000 crores, roughly around 12,000 to 15,000 crores will be lost in the marketplace. Remember, when that happens, 90% of the Indian companies which are running today will be out of business. Because 50,000 profitability of the entire industry is an average is less than 20%. So most of the companies in India would be wiped out overnight. All the big companies will be wiped. I'm talking about Indian companies. Multinationals will not be there at all. The Indian companies will be wiped out if that happens and a shift takes place from 5% to 90%. Unemployment would be at such a massive scale that you will not appreciate. There are roughly around about 5 lakhs plus sales force. They will be mostly would be unemployed because they don't need sales force now. Marketing would be done directly to the chemists. So there is no need of sales force. There would be no formulation development, so the entire scientist community will go out of business. Now this is very scary, if you ask me. If somebody takes this view of shifting it the other way around and saying that we want this to be a generic country. Let's stay with that thought process and move forward. Local companies dominating in India, almost 80%, and 20% are multinational. Branded generics, 90%, 2%. Market is driven by volume. 60% is volume growth. And when the generic happens, who is going to expand the market? Who is going to provide the feet on the ground? Who is going to increase the number of touch points? Who is going to go to rural areas or extra-urban areas? Who is going to disseminate information to the doctors? Those are big challenges that we're going to face as we move forward. Brands classifications. Today we have almost 28,000 brands. All of these 28,000 brands, 25,000 brands belong to Indian companies. And 3,000 brands belong to multinational companies. 90% of the brands of the Indian companies will be wiped out. So you can be sure 90% of the Indian companies will be wiped out. Multinational companies will be not wiped out globally. They may be wiped out from India, but not globally. So who is the loser at the end of the day? Are we targeting multinational companies or we are targeting our own companies? I think we are targeting our own companies. We are killing the geese that lays the golden egg. I think that's the biggest challenge nobody has understood. What are we doing when we are moving this paradigm and saying that this is how we want to run the business? Generic products in US, this is very, very important to understand. Contains same ingredient as innovative products. Is a bioequivalent to patented drugs. Is identical in strength, dosage form, and route of administration. Requires efficacy and safety data. I am asking a question. Even the branded generics in India, do they qualify in this criteria? Not at all. The US regulations of a generics is very, very stringent. They are almost as stringent as the original product. And therefore, they encourage generics because they are confident that the generics that patients will be using is as close or almost the same as original products. Do we have that confidence in India? In India, after 4 years, anybody can launch a product. Where is the bioequivalence? Where is the data? What is the confidence level this is the same product which is the original product? I'll give you case studies which are very interesting. There is this institute of epilepsy called the Newfoundland and Labrador Institute. They did some studies. And there was this lady called Anita. Anita. She changed one generic product to another generic product and experience painful gas and diarrhea. I'm saying to move from a generic product to another generic product. And there's another case of a gentleman who moved from a Prozac, which was original product, to another version of a generic, and he broke into rash. The ingredient was the same, the excipients were different. That small excipients he was allergic to created rashes. But these are documented cases, the risk we are taking with the patients, with you and me, we are all at risk when this happens. Because I don't know whether we'll get boils or rashes or what we'll get, but definitely we will not survive when the industry becomes generic. That's one for sure. You will have to all go to US or Europe or somewhere to buy their medicines and come back. It's going to be the other way around. So that's going to be the challenge that we're going to face. Branded generics products in India. A generics products of patented in India. It's a first approval based on US and European approvals. Subsequent approvals need only to have pharmacokinetic bioequivalence. And finally, the product 4 years require no regulatory approvals. Most of the generics today, when they get converted, will form into the 4 years category, which will have no standards of regulations. Absolutely no standards of regulation. Generic drugs. Government is aggressively pushing. There are states which are champions, Tamil Nadu, Kerala, AP, Rajasthan. There are shops of the government, they are coming up, Jan Aushadhi program. God bless the patients. Prescribed generic drugs is what government doctors are told. This is a Times of India statement that doctors were told to prescribe only generic drugs. And this is recorded by Down to Earth, a doctor's statement saying, in many cases, generic drugs do not provide the desired effect in the expected time which branded ones do. These doctors are not multinational doctors. They are Indian doctors who are making these comments. Risk to patients with generic drugs. Many single ingredient medicines have difference in formulations and drug delivery system that could have varied impact on the patient. Active ingredients may be different, having impact on absorption. Mind you, active ingredients may be the same, but the therapeutic equivalence may not exist. So a lot of, I remember one of the drugs, I won't name the company, because it's one of the top 10 companies, so I don't want to spoil the show here. We had a drug which was highly technology protected drugs. And the drug was supposed to deliver, the medicine was supposed to deliver the drug in a very released fashion over 24 hours. Somebody else introduced it in the market, we tested it, and we found in the first 4 hours, the quantum of the drug that get released in the body is proportionately much higher than it gets released later on. Now what does it do? The first 4 hours are very critical. And when the quantum goes high, even the patient may suffer stroke. This was brought to the notice of the FDI and saying that this is what it is. And nothing happened. Nothing. This is the risk we face when we talk about generics. Because our regulations are not on par with US regulations. Once you are in par, I have no problems on generics. Because I'm at risk, my kids are at risk, you are at risk, your families are at risk. Why do we want to be at risk by this generics being consumed by us? It's a simple question that I'm asking. Most of the products do not have data to prove similar efficacy and safety against original or even against other generics. Substitution is common. You're moving the power from more knowledgeable people to less knowledgeable people. From doctors to chemists. And most of these guys are not even educated guys there. They are coming from Rajasthan with a small ring here and selling you pills. Understand. Now, once that happens, what happens? The consideration there is only high profit margins, and there is no other consideration. And if substitution happens, it's going to be a huge challenge. There's another big challenge in Indian context. Do you know 50% of the Indian market is a combination market?
50% of the Indian market is a combination market, and 50% is single ingredient. In that single ingredient, there are so many changes, coated, uncoated, slow release, excipients are different, and dyes and binders and so on and so forth, and fillers. How will you define what is equivalent to original product? In case of combination, it's ruled out, and in case the product has been changed as in excipients or it's in form of delivery, how will you say it's the same product as the original product? So I think we are risking almost about 80% of the drugs which will not have really no relevance to the original product. This is my submission for your consideration. So, a case for branded generics. A branded generic guy is more at risk in not adhering to quality, because if his brand gets challenged, he loses his forever. He's responsible for monitoring. You talked about adverse events. I remember a case where there was a death, and the doctor called the generic company and said, I had prescribed your product and there is a death. He said, sir, I don't know about this, because this product is manufactured by Pfizer. So when it comes to death or adverse events, it's manufactured by Pfizer. Means we are the original products, but actually it is manufactured by him and supplied as generics, but he's not responsible for that. And I'm supposed to follow the adverse events and reports. Patient under the heads of knowledge shareholder, doctor is aware of the... Now this is very important. Doctor is aware of the condition of the patient, and doctor is here, we can elaborate on that. And he is best suited to say what medicine will work and what strength it will work. And I think that discretion should be left to the doctor and not to the chemist. So we need to strike a balance. I cannot be talking only and saying that no, generics are not good and so on and so forth. Then I'll have to have a debate with Amir Khan. But you need to strike a balance. And the balance really is in having an holistic approach. And the holistic approach is you need to strengthen the regulation first before we talk about generics. And that is what we need to do, is bring the best of the regulation, implement those. Bringing is one thing, actually implementing is another thing. Discourage any generics in combinations just will not work. Expand the healthcare insurance to provide excess medicines. Because what is the rationale for using generics? It's low cost. The best way to do is to look at other means of providing access. In healthcare, insurance is one of them. Counterfeit measures need to be strengthened before we talk of generic. Once the generic comes in, believe me, 80% of the market will be counterfeit. How will you ensure that there are no counterfeit products? That's very critical. And finally, stringent requirement for generic formulation procurement. In drugs having narrow therapeutic equivalents, this is the biggest challenge. Where there is a very, very narrow therapeutic equivalent and you still bring a generic here, you are sure the patient is not going to survive. And that, I think, is the holistic approach we need to bring in if really we want to talk about generics in this country. Reducing the price of molecules through supply of low-cost generic is palliative, not a cure to country ills. Thank you very much.
Satya Brahma to give the memento to Kewal Handa. It's a beautiful presentation, sir. And a lot of actually the thought on branded generic and generic. You made it clear. Chemical equivalence is not bioequivalence. I think that is the principle as far as the drugs manufacturing is considered. Before we can go to the next speaker, there is a request that somebody has not parked the car properly. MH01AH9916 Santro and MH05AS8774. So kindly actually do the needful if it is your car. India is a great country. have the allopathy, we have the naturopathy, and we also have the homeopathy. And the person who made the brand of homeopathy and himself is Dr. Batra. To build quality, we always say you and your attitude is important. And we have with us Dr. Mukesh Batra, the founder chairman of Dr. Batra's Positive Clinic, delivering the keynote speech on making of Dr. Batra's brand. Indian experience versus global challenges. Dr. Mukesh Batra, please.
Thank you very much for your kind introduction, and thank you, Satya, for having given this opportunity. Ladies and gentlemen, a very good evening to all of you. I'm not going to give you a formal talk or lecture, but I'm going to share with you the experiences of my brand, and that's what I've been asked to do with Satya. So let's kick off straight away. First, let's think of what does it take to be a good brand. And I think the first thing that comes to mind is that brands must commit to a central philosophy. And I think the challenge that I had when I started my company 13 years ago was, how do I build a value-based company? And how do I build and how do I imbibe, you know, values, ethics, integrity, and trust and honesty in young doctors, many of whom have just passed out from college and were very, very eager to make money, not through medicine, but even through the stock market. And therefore, I think the first challenge is how to make sure that there is a central philosophy, and then how to imbibe it in every person from top to down in the organization. Second, of course, to have a good brand, we must have high recall and high visibility. And we are lucky to do that by way of making sure that we have very visible clinics which are right in the marketplace, you know, so that people, when they walk past, and with the more clinics that you have, the more visibility you get, and therefore you get a higher branding and brand recall. Very important that to have a good brand, we must have and develop a word of mouth. I want to mention here, as a practicing doctor for more than 40 years, that in medicine, the biggest quality is trust. And the patients actually trust their doctors, and when they trust their doctors, they very often say that you do what you think is right for me. And therefore, very often, especially in India, medical decisions are taken by doctors rather than by patients and their families. That's the level of trust that patients have in their doctors in India. And therefore, it's very important to develop this trust and to build this trust. Now, this can only happen by actually getting good cure rates, by actually delivering your promise, and by actually, you know, putting your foot where your mouth is and making sure that you actually deliver. And so you need to have a very good word of mouth. And I'm happy to say that at Dr. Batra's, 50% of our patients come by references and by word of mouth. A key factor to be a good brand is what I believe, that brands reside not in the minds of people, but in their hearts. And therefore, I think it's not just about brand recall, but it's about how can you give an emotional connect to your patient, how can you create an emotional connect to your customer or your consumer, even if you're a pharmaceutical company. And how do you do that? And with us at Dr. Batra's, our tagline has been, healing people, changing lives. And therefore, we've actually taken the stand of making sure that everything that we do is measured according to a health-related quality of life, HRQL. And I'd like to share with you some, just some examples. For example, a 37-year-old person who could not get married because he had severe psoriasis, and everybody went to see a girl, they just rejected him, and he went into great depression. It affected not only him, but also his family. And when his psoriasis was cured, he actually got married and his level of confidence increased. So there are many cases like this. For example, of a young girl in her 30s who could not conceive because she had ovarian cysts. She had polycystic ovarian. And the harassment that she had with her mother-in-law, telling her all the time that, why are you not able to have a child? What's wrong? And even the husband at some stage saying that, all right, I'll get married somewhere else if you can't produce a kid. And then getting rid of those cysts and then making her conceive was one of the happiest moments of her life. Think of a young asthmatic child. 7-year-old child gets up with asthma. The parents are frantic. They are so worried that this would be the child's last breath. Most asthmatic attacks happen at night. And that's the time when there's very little medical help. So ultimately, it's the parents or the caregiver or the caretaker, which is local, has actually got to look after them. A child is not allowed by parents to go out for picnics, for sleepovers, for parties, for fear of falling sick and getting an attack. And therefore, the child loses confidence, and so do people around him. And therefore, having given, you know, kind of breath and life back to that child and made him all right and not get an asthmatic attack, not only improves his life, but also the life of people all around him. I've seen in my practice that health does not affect just the patient, but it affects families, it affects well-wishers, it also affects communities. It affects people around. And therefore, when you heal somebody, you're not healing one person, but you're actually giving relief to the entire family. I've seen that there's been a spastic child, for example, in a family. And I've seen the mother of that child has not taken a holiday for the last 20 years. Because they don't want to cart him around, they don't want to travel with him, they can't do it. And therefore, they just are there. I've seen a young lady who's now become middle-aged, not getting married. Why? Because she's got an elderly father to take care of, who's bedridden. And so many such cases. So I think when you talk about health, it's very important that you only don't talk about physical health, but you also talk about holistic health, mental health, emotional health. And you try to connect that with the patient. And if you're able to do that, that's how you're actually able to build a very strong, lasting brand. Talking about our brand story, I started my practice in 1974 as a regular homeopath like anybody else, like a regular doctor. In 1982, I set up the first branded clinic, which was called Positive Health Clinic at that time. And it was the first clinic which had computerized, you know, electronic data, case records, a software which I made. Unfortunately, I needed funds and there was no money coming for healthcare, least of all for homeopathy. A bank said that, you know, even doctors can't pay that kind of amount, how will you pay? And a homeopath will never be able to pay. And so I had to borrow money at 36% per annum, which is 3% per month, which was the highest rate of interest at that time. And the only industry which had that kind of premium in interest rates was the film industry because it was so risky. So I dare say that homeopathy at that time was as risky as the film industry because that's how loans came in. And today you get marketing people calling you on your mobile phone and saying, please take money from us. But at that time, it was just the other way around. And people also said that when I wanted to buy a computer, I remember, because that time computers had just come into the country in 1982. And they said, why are you paying 1,75,000 to, you know, buy this? And it was actually called a green monster. Because if you remember, when it came to India, it had a green screen and used to have a screen saver so that your eyes wouldn't get spoiled. And had a printer which was the size of half this table. And every time I took out a prescription, the whole building used to shake. Because it is dot matrix, it's got tuck, 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 you know, almost like an AK-47. So we started with that. And it wasn't really easy. And people said, why are you doing this? Why don't we instead take 10 doctors as assistants with the same amount of money that we're spending there? But I think ultimately, building a brand is all about building a vision. And it's all about building a dream and it's all about living that dream. And I think that's what we did at that time. In 1996, I gave up my practice and said, I'm not happy doing general practice because I used to see 300, 400 patients in a day. And I never knew whether they got well or whether they went to hospital or whether they went to Kewal Handa for Pfizer treatment. I had no idea what they did. And so I decided that I've got to actually make sure that I have a select practice. And so we narrowed down our practice to 14 specialties, which we got great relief for patients over the last 20 years. And we brought in an agency and we did research and we narrowed down to 14, you know, specialties. And then again, there was a major shift and a major change at that time. And then again, there were no patients coming for, you know, almost 1 year. From 325 patients a day, the practice went to 2 patients a week. But we again had belief and held on to that. And within 1 year, we were all full and we had no appointments for 1 year. So we actually evolved again from general practice to specialty practice. In 2000, we decided that we can't keep running around like this in multiple cities and practicing. And therefore, we must corporatize the practice because we believe that, you know, with doctors I've seen, with all my friends and so many doctors, that, you know, the practice dies with them. Because when they die, then it just dies with them. I think if you have to live on, you know, people come and go, but corporates live forever. And I think that's the philosophy that we wanted to imbibe. And therefore, we corporatized it. And that again took a huge effort because in the beginning, there was nobody willing to come and work for a brand because professional people were not willing except for homeopaths. And so to start with, we had a homeopath who was an HR manager, and we had a homeopath who was a financial consultant, and we have a homeopath, you know, we had a doctor who was doing everything. And our doctors were actually then driven to success and to do every role that was required of them. And slowly, gradually, I think after 5 years, we actually managed to get in very good professional people. And today, I'm happy to say that 13 years down the road, we run our company independently. We have CEOs for every vertical that we have.